Now I have to admit, I was a little bit nervous about introducing the next speaker, because that's my boss, Tewes Tralau. Tewes has studied biology and toxicology in Konstanz, and then later on did postdoctoral research in Manchester, in Shanghai, but also in Strasbourg. He joined BFR in 2010, where he worked in different positions, heading a unit in the chemicals safety department, and is now head of pesticide safety department. He will be talking on mixture risk assessment, 20 years of toxicology, and still no quick fix. Can NAMs finally provide a solution? I have a guess what the answer may be, but I will leave it to you to give it. Tewes, thanks a lot, and the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you for the kind introduction. Actually, my speakers preceding me have said it all, so I can just quit. No, that's a joke. I will actually pick up on where they left the topic. And of course, mixture assessment as such, or the question if you can access mixtures properly, is quite old. It's actually as old as toxicology. And we have now seen today different numbers, various numbers, on how many chemicals are there around. That always depends on how you count it and where you look for it for. So we have around 350,000 chemicals marketed worldwide. And we have had a closer look, at least here in the European Union, at something like 30 to 50K, 20 to 30 under reach. And the reason for that, that we have this situation, is that toxicological assessments, and that has good legal reasons and reasons for management, and the data requirements to do those assessments are usually still subject to separate silos. And I've taken the liberty here to list the silos for Europe, where we basically have separate legislations for certain parts, and then we have some overarching legislations, such as the REACH legislation and the CLP legislation, and we have the food additives, which are a bit on the side. If you now look at the data requirements that we have in those legislations, then we have procedures where you have approval procedures, and then we have continue further to the right, where we end up with REACH in the middle, with registration and authorization, and then risk assessments on the left-hand side. And the more you move to the left, the less data you actually have for those substances to assess them. And in terms of legal procedures, the separation and silos runs are reliable and sound regulation. So that's basically where Maurice left us. However, this comes at the price of some regulatory uncertainty and gap, because exposure across the frameworks are only accommodated to a very limited extent. And that's the reason why we are discussing mixture toxicity actually today. Because if you only look at the exposures within those legal silos, then of course you don't look at the potential mixture effects in a degree as you should be in order to have the best possible health protection that you are aiming for. And if you look at which of those legislations actually require to do some cross assessments and to do the assessment of some mixture effects, then you have those requirements in the plant protection products and the biocides, you have it with the pharmaceuticals, and you have it to a certain degree with the plastics with food contact. And if you then ask the question, are those assessments going across silos, or are they actually staying within those silos, then you will see that apart from the food contact materials, most of those assessments are just done within the silos, and it's only the food contact materials that look across their own silo. So this actually immediately leaves you with three questions, and all of those have been discussed today already, and I will now try to add some of my thoughts to that. The first obvious question is this a problem? The second question then would be, if so, how big and pressing is it? And the first question then, can we adequately deal with it? Now, is it a problem? We know that there is a possibility of mixture effects, so you could basically leave it at that and then, of course, it could be a problem, but I find that quite unsatisfying, because coming from that point, you have to ask, in which cases is this a problem? So for mixture effects to occur, you have to have several preconditions, and that's regardless of in which context you're looking at the problem. You have to have co-exposure to the substances in question at relevant doses, so at a point where the body cannot compensate for that exposure anymore. And you have action on pathways affecting the same endpoints that can be either similar pathways or dissimilar pathways, but they have to affect the same endpoint. If we look at the current data, we don't see any indication of it to be a real imminent concern, but still there is this lingering uncertainty because we know there might be a problem about it. And these uncertainties especially remain for chronic endpoints because there, of course, it's very hard to do any predictions. And we don't have enough data here to say either it's a problem or it's not a problem, so we should have a closer look at it and identify in which cases this might be a problem. So how big of a problem is it? And Anna-Marie Ouvry basically introduced very nicely the options already that we have for the action on dissimilar and similar modes. And so mixture effects can be additive and they can also be synergistic. Most of the known mixture effects are additive, and I've added one more example here below. Basically, I'm not going to go through this graph in detail, but what you will see is you have two substances that have a dose response curve, and if you take half of each substance, mix it together, you have the very same dose response curve. So that's a classical example of an additive effect. Synergism, of course, occurs less frequently and is usually restricted to a fold range if you look at it between 2 and 100. Ree already said it, there are very few cases that are well described for synergism. I've added one here where we can clearly say that is synergism, which basically is working in a dissimilar mode. And so, if we see that, then we have to think of some other facts as well. First of all, additivity. So for most additive mixtures, the mixture effects, and that was nicely shown before as well, are subject to so-called drivers. So within those mixtures, you have single substances that have a particular strong impact on how this mixture acts. And that is normally overall driven by a number of limited and identifiable substances. For synergism, Ree said it as well, we have very few examples where we have established synergism, and for many of those that are quoted in the low dose range, actually it's unsure because there you have pitfalls like the gatekeeper effect, if that is really synergism or basically just additivity with some added uncertainty. And then you have this effect that the more constituents you have in a mixture, the more likely it is that some of those constituents will actually overrule and take over any potential synergism you might have in there, and you end up with this additive effect again, because some of the substances then act stronger as the others, or basically start driving the mixture. So that's the reason why, in practice, when you look at the examples that are known, additive assessments are known to be sufficiently conservative in nearly all cases. Now, how big of a problem is it? Don't be afraid, it's a highly complicated graph. That was a calculation that was done by a very capable postdoc of mine a few years back. And actually, the question was, if we simulate the situation of a mixture where we have unknown chemicals with unknown potency factors, we just add that together, in which of those cases would we actually, under the current risk assessment, see an effect or oversee an effect? Because under the current risk assessment, of course, we also have uncertainty factors already in there. They're in there for different reasons, but they actually act in the assessment. And what you see is on these graphs above the big graphs is the distribution of the potency factors. And we chose potency factors between 5 and 30, and then we basically added these up into a mixture and asked how many factors, how many substances with those distributions do we have to add in order to see an exceedance of a safety factor of 1,000 or 100 in 30% of the cases. And what we saw is that if you have the standard safety factor of 100, that means you have to have 3 to 11 substances acting together with a potency range of 10 to 30. If you have a safety factor of 1,000, that would require 21 to 36 substances with a potency range of 30 to 50. And now, mind, most known potencies are actually below 10. So we are already here in a very conservative range. And if you then remember that you have the need for concomitant exposure, so there has to be the exposure at sufficiently high levels all the time, then you get an idea why mixture effects don't occur that frequently, but why you also have to consider them. So it just gives you an idea how big the problem might be. So we can say that the problem is most likely limited in extent and remit, but it still needs addressing. And particularly it needs addressing because we have this ever-increasing exposure to chemicals. So that's just a matter of time. And with mixer toxicity being a subject to those preconditions that I quoted, the main objective should now be to identify basically the cases where these current assessment practices fail to notice critical co-exposures or fail to notice critical effects. And if you look at that and you go a little bit back and remember that we are looking at assessments and silo-specific solutions, then it becomes immediately recognizable why it might not be such a good idea then to approach this problem again silo-specific, but why you should think outside the box and approach this not in silos. And just to exemplify this a little bit, we have had a look at 428 substances that are listed, were listed for plant protection in 2016. And out of these, 38 were registered for biocidal use and 55 were registered also under REACH. It's a very small example, but it shows you actually that when you look at it silo-specific, you run into problems there. And that would be the same if you address it just within silos. So we need A, solutions that go across the silos and that are based on exposure and accommodate this exposure and that accommodate the potential of increased hazard due to effects. I have exemplified this here once more with this graph. You have seen it presented by Jacob as well. So the aim has to be to come to an wholesome assessment and basically address the problem across the different remits. So for the exposure to assess or not to assess might be the question, we have data-rich compounds. And there we have all the data we might wish for. So we have comprehensive data on the hazard, we have comprehensive data on the exposure, and examples for this is the plant protection products where we really have plenty of data, usually for the exposure as well as for the toxicity, or some of the high production volume chemicals under REACH. And here actually we have very good approaches already that would allow us to address this data driven like common assessment groups. And on the other hand, you have data poor compounds where you have limited or no data on the hazard, which is quite a lot out there that was quoted repeatedly today. And we have even less data on the exposure. And that is the case for many of contaminants or low production volume chemicals under REACH or those that are even not registered under REACH whatsoever. And there is one idea that you could proceed with NAMs, and I'm going to exemplify a little bit later how. So first for the data-rich substances. If you really are having the option of buying the full basket, then of course you have the hazard data for the target organs with all the effects known, and you can sort those accordingly. So basically you know which of those substances will affect which organ. You have monitoring data, for example, from food monitoring, and you have food baskets for the different groups in the population. And for those substances, you can do grouping according to the toxicology. You can then do cumulative assessment groups. You just have to decide if you want to have that as a cumulative or assessment group or a kinetic group. And then you can calculate the combined exposure based on this data, and you can perform an additive assessment. And in those cases where we've done that, we actually see that we get a pretty good outcome and are sufficiently conservative. Then you have, I called it a little bit provocatively here, data poor substances where we know little, yet still something. And that are actually those substances that were quoted today as well, which are normally the examples that are quoted by everyone, like dioxins, PFAS or so, where you can still group those substances according to structure, then derive potency factors, you know, on which AOPs those substances are acting, and then you can calculate combined hazard based on these values, and you can apply the assessment additively again. And then you have where those vast amount of substances where you have hardly any data, where you have actually to make a decision. What are you looking at and under which conditions are you looking at? I called it here the need to separate the good from the bad and the ugly. And this is a tremendously difficult graph. It's from a paper we published on there, and I'm going to take you through it. If you look at panel A, that's the way we do it classically. So we have an animal experiment. We would have to have the hazard data. Then we would have to look at the exposure. Then we do our risk assessment, and then we come to a conclusion. Now, if you think about 350,000 chemicals, that's not possible to do that. It's basically trying to mimic Sisyphus. On the other hand, we heard from Thomas today, the vast amount of available NAM methodologies, and I would even go beyond that, NAMs is not only everything that you can do in silico and in vitro, but it is also data that you get from animal experiments where you have additional data according to the standard routines. And at least for the in silico data, for the AI data, and for the in vitro data, those NAMs normally have the capacity to be done in high speed, high throughput, and they give you some valuable information, not on the potency, as Maurice rightfully put out, or fit to make a decision, but what they give you is they give you hazard alerts. So basically, what you now can think of is there a way of having an exposure filter and then looking for those NAMs to basically look what you're looking at in a further downstream point, maybe in animal experiments or whatever you want to use then. So the idea is you would take or compile a matrix of chemicals from all the legislations that we have, from the REACH database, from the pesticides database, from the biocides database, everything that is available there. And then for the exposure, you would basically compile a similar matrix for probabilistic co-exposure. And you can do that with the data that are out there. It hasn't been done yet, but the wealth of data that is available would allow you to do that. You have data on what people eat, you have data on what people use. You have, if you go beyond that, data on what is sold. You have all the people science data. You can basically implement monitoring devices. You have data on, or you could tap into data what people buy in the supermarkets, which gives you also information on which products come together and are likely to act together. And then, of course, with all those data, you can make a co-exposure matrix using probability approaches and sort that to groups of substances and combinations of substances where you should pay closer attention because they are very frequent in terms of the likelihood for exposure. And those then you can feed into a NAM setting where you would compare the single results for the single substances for the combinations, and that would give you some idea on which ones you are missing, which ones are actually combinations you should pay attention to, and then you would mine and review that together with the classical toxicity data and then can decide how you would take a regulatory action on that, if you would do it generically, if you require more in vivo data, or in whatever way you deem to see to be fit. And the advantage of such an approach is it is open in the methodology, quite open actually, but it allows you to do an assessment across the legal silos. So actually it would be going really for this one substance, one assessment, one setting, one assessment, one exposure, one assessment. And that would bring us far closer to the aim of having a consistent approach on how we regulate substances than we had it before. And I've seen Philip is already reminding me that I should come to an end, and with that I shall come to an end. It's the last slide. So, any questions?